And you can see Monty Hall's great Hebridean Escape on Wednesday at 9 on BBC Two. Now, our next guest is a world-renowned rock star with a 30-year career, over 40 million albums. Yeah, of course it is Meatloaf. Welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much. I'm watching those. I should be more dramatic, I think. I'm a little underplayed in those videos. I think I need to come out of my shell a little bit more.
Because you're actually quite a shy man, aren't you?
I am, yeah, I am very shy.
I was thinking
But
that.
I heard before that you ran the marathon, right?
Yeah, I'm doing it next week.
3:23 before?
Oh, I wish.
But how come... Oh, you didn't
353.
Run 353. Oh, 353. Yeah. Oh, that's why I didn't see you at the finish line. But no, I mean, I was 3 days and 23 hours. And you were 3 days and... Oh, 3 hours and 50. Oh.
Are you quite into your exercise, mate?
Excuse me?
Are you quite into exercise, mate?
Yes, I get up every morning and go in and wash my face and go back to bed.
That's quite a lot of
energy required. Yeah, I want to get that, I want to get that heart, that blood pumping, you know what
That's
I mean?
It. Do you know,
looking at
the videos, the music videos there, why did you decide to cut all your hair off? Because that was your kind of state, that was your symbol.
It was because, you see, when I would go out with long hair, everybody recognized me. And I lived in the same house. And I would go into the shopping malls or the stores and people would talk to me. And I cut my hair off and I would go into the same stores and nobody said a word to me.
Yeah, but they do
and
now.
It was a wonderful thing. What's that?
They do now, though. Obviously, they
recognize. Yeah, they just say, get out of the way, fat guy.
How many countries were you... Yeah, I mean, that seems obviously massive over here, massive in the States. Did it go the whole world, even into Asia?
Anything for Love? Yeah, it was
number one
in 28 countries or something like that.
Is there anywhere...
Oh, it was stupid, is what it was. I mean, it's like, wow.
Is there anywhere in the world you can go where you don't get recognized?
I don't... There must be some place that I don't get recognized. The Sudan.
what's the weirdest place that you have been recognized then?
The weirdest place in the women's bathroom.
Interesting.
You shouldn't be in there.
Well, that's why it was weird now, wasn't it? What are you doing in here? No, so I don't know what the weirdest place is.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Right, let's talk about your new album you've got out. It's a concept album, which is a weird concept for us these days with the iTunes atmosphere that we live in now, where people just buy singles. You've actually done an album which has a concept behind it.
Yeah, and I did an album, and I really call this the most important album I've ever made. And I got to be perfectly honest with you, I couldn't do any better than this record. I've given all my blood. I've given everything. Look at me. I've aged like almost 60 years. And
how long's it taken to kind of compile this album?
It flew by. Rob Cavallo produced. He's the best producer in the world because he allowed me to be me and never said no. And he allowed me to just be me. I'm a kind of friendly kind of guy, and I have friends, and I like to use my friends. And so Hugh Laurie's a friend of mine, Jack Black's a friend of mine, and as we're making the record, people say, oh, we use names for the name's sake. I don't. They're friends. It's like, Jack, what are you doing? Let's have some coffee. Okay, cool. And Jack, I got this part you can sing with me. You'll sound great. And then I didn't see him, and then I forgot. And then he comes up to me and goes... Jack comes up to me at a charity event and goes, dude, Meat, I thought we were going to jam, dude. So, sorry, it's Sunday morning. I need to back off of you. I understand that. I'm trying. I realize that it's Sunday morning, and I usually am full of energy, and I, I'm trying to just be a little calm for your Sunday morning.
There's some people tucked up behind their doors.
That's right, they are. Oh. And if Meatloaf comes on as Meatloaf, if they'll just like pass out. It'll, you know, we'll have emergencies everywhere. 911, Meatloaf's on TV.
I love the fact though, that Hugh Laurie was on this.
Yeah, I didn't know he's a rock star.
I think Hugh Laurie wants to be. It appears that everyone wants to be a rock star, except for rock stars who now want to be presenters or. Athletes.
Yeah.
Actors.
Yeah. When Hugh Laurie turned up to record it, did he turn up full in leathers and kind of in that kind of biker
basically
way?
Kind of no, but he did turn up with his English accent driving his Porsche, which I really like. But he was really nervous. And Rob Cavallo saw that he was really nervous.
He plays the piano for anyone who doesn't know. He's not singing.
Playing piano. Good. Yes, we would have confused him. But he said to me when I first met him, "You don't remember me, do you?" And I looked at him on the set because I was doing a house, and I went, "No." He said, "We worked together in '85 on Saturday Night in the UK." And I said, "We did?" And he goes, "Yeah, we did 3 comedy sketches." And I said, "Oh." I said, "What were they?" And he said, "Well, there was this one, this one, and a taxi driver." And I said, "Oh, yeah, the taxi driver. I remember that." And he said, "So you remember me?" I went, "No."
Oh.
But this record, this record is amazing.
There will be people out there who watch this show who don't know what a concept album is. What is the concept?
I get a little sidetracked. I'm old. I don't know any different. It's the story of a soldier who is dying, and instead of his life flashing backwards, it flashes forward. And it was written by a screenwriter friend of mine named Killian Kerwin, who does a lot of work for the Scott brothers, Toby and Ridley. It's an amazing story, and the short story, which is included in one of the, is fantastic. And everybody that played is amazing. The drums are amazing. Let me just look at me right in the eyes. I'm in love with my record, okay?
It's not just good.
I'm in love with it.
And it's called Hand Cool Teddy Bear, the album, and we've got actually a clip of one of the singles on it, which is called Los Angeloser.
Los Angeloser.
There we go. Let's have a look.
Is that out now? Can you buy it?
The album comes out Monday.
Right.
As far as I don't know, I never know anything except for the album comes out Monday.
And are you touring it?
Yeah.
We'll tour it. But on that video, you know, I thought it might be funny if I tried to dance along, and the director and the choreographer, again, just like when I did theater in New York, choreographers would come over to me and go, "We don't need you in this number. You know, if you're going to be on stage, can you get in the back, like behind the curtain somewhere?" And so I thought it would be funny if I tried to do some of the dances they did. And the director and the choreographer came over to me and said, "I think you should just stay behind that podium there and not move around too much, okay? You're like about as coordinated as a small porcupine."
That's what people say to me when I go clubbing as well. Can you
really?
Just go and stand over there away from the dance floor, please?
All right, now listen.
Well, would you like to go dancing tonight then?
Meatloaf will be staying with us and doing some cooking. Are you any good at cooking?
Like Meatloaf, do I cook?
We'll be taking your emails, so if you've got a question to ask him or Diana Vickers, drop us a line via our website, bbc.co.uk/ something for the weekend.
Yeah, but now here's what else is coming up on the rest of the show. Oh, that is my weakness.
For some extra flavour. And then we have a little bit of cream as well.
Oh.
And then, obviously, just for our 5 a day, some strawberries.
Mm.
There we go. Go for it.
Would you try that?
Thank you very much.
Enjoy. Try that, please.
Do you know that I've gained 15 pounds just looking at this thing?
It's good. It's good.
I believe it's good.
Yeah, it is.
It's worth 15 pounds?
Yeah. Mom, try it.
Okay.
Right, it's amazing.
Nice?
Somebody's like birthday cake.
It's quite a strong flavour, but the sponge doesn't feel too heavy.
Okay, well, you're trying that. Coming up, we've got Moroccan spaghetti for brunch, but now, what do you think?
That is good. That was good. It doesn't leave that dry.
I hated it!
Now time for another film clip. If speed dating wasn't difficult enough, try having your long-dead relatives there. Well, here is a wonderful afterlife.
A And you can see Out of the Frying Pan on Monday at 9 on BBC Two. Now time for Lazy Brunch, and we're joined by Meatloaf. I think we're about to go to the frying pan here.
I don't eat meat, but I'm still rocking. I'm a rock chef.
You're working that apron
I'm working the jacket and the apron, big time.
It's good. It's a good look.
It's a good look, yeah.
Does it worry you that he's put an apron on? Does he know something we don't?
It scares me slightly.
It's supposed to.
Yeah.
I'm a scary dude, man.
The stare has always been the thing, actually, on your videos.
Oh,
it's
always been that
stare. No.
See, that's... Well, you get that from raising kids, right? So, so when you don't... You go...
Yeah.
You see... Do it down the camera. Go on, do a stare. Oh, that's quite scary, that is.
My kids are behind the sofa at home now.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. That's it. Or if you're the bad guys in the movies.
Do you tend to play a lot of bad guys in movies, maybe?
Yeah, and I die in all of them, so I can never be in the remake.
Are you a chef?
Dude. No.
No. Clearly, no.
And I'm not very good in baseball either. So anyway, you know what? I know what he's making, see?
Okay, what we are making, we're making Moroccan spaghetti.
That's right. And you know what? I make the same thing at home. And I know, let's see if you got all the ingredients right. Okay,
all right. So what I do with mine, hope this matches.
No, wait a minute, see.
We've got some flaked almonds, we've got some chickpeas. And we've got mint, and we've got parsley, we've got coriander.
Onion.
We've got spaghetti that we've cooked. Lots of olive oil.
Cumin.
Onion, garlic,
cumin.
Tomato.
And you got the secret, cinnamon.
Cinnamon, turmeric, cumin.
That's it.
Good work. Fantastic. All right, so first job, big man.
You have the almonds, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But now you know. Do you know there is a trick to chopping an onion?
Chop away from
it.
No,
see.
But it's how you cut it.
Oh, really?
But I can't remember how it is. Can you tell me?
What? So you want fine? You want fine dice?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, when you
just
when
don't want to cry. But, do
no,
you?
No, this no. What no, I always want to cry. I cried everything.
So what you want? You cut down the middle.
That's right. That's it.
And then we go.
That's it. I remember this now.
Okay.
But there's you got to do this at home, because don't just start slicing your onion. You got to remember that the best way to cut an onion is what he just did. See, down the middle. there's a rule to all this stuff, and you just got to remember it, right? And then you just go at it, right?
So we.
Okay.
Well, basically, what we're making is, so imagine it's that lovely thing of Moroccan flavors. So all the things.
No, I'm just
all the things like cumin and coriander and cinnamon is that really delicious ingredient in lots of Moroccan food. Then what we've got are tomatoes. So these are delicious tomatoes, but
they look good.
Oh, sort of squishy old ones are probably the best thing to use.
Okay.
Which of course, come the end of the week when Tim's prediction of no food in the country, then this will be easy to do. You could use tinned, but there's something delicious about using fresh ones. Well, whatever you want, really. Basically, what we're going to make is we're going to make a tomato-based sauce. Okay, so we squish those fellas up. You can even chuck them in whole and just break them down. All right, now what we do with our onion and with the tomato.
Go for it, dude.
Thank you.
That's not bad.
All right. And then that goes in, and we cook that out for a few minutes or so. We've got a bit of garlic. All we do with the garlic, just bash it and chuck that in.
Absolutely. Oh, I was going to do that.
Mate,
I know to bash the garlic.
We've got other jobs for you. And then in go all the tomatoes as well. And then what you do. We then chuck in our spices, cumin, cinnamon, and turmeric. The turmeric, of course, will give a really nice yellow colour to it. Plenty of salt and pepper into there. Good man.
Well done. That's a good contribution.
Great, that's good. Cook that out for about 20, 25 minutes or so. And what happens is the onion softens, all the spices cook out, and we end up with this really delicious...
Does that look like yours?
Is that about right,
do
you think?
It's probably much better because he cooked it.
But it's similar.
People don't eat mine.
Yeah. And then next job. Okay, so our herbs. We've got coriander and we've got parsley. Mm-hmm. So again, you've got the mintiness, you've got the freshness there, you've got the grassiness of the parsley, and then the aromatic of the coriander.
Have you cut yours?
Yeah.
You could tear
if you wanted.
I tear.
Things like parsley though, if you don't chop it, then you end up with bits stuck in your teeth, which is not really what
we
want.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, so what we're gonna do, we're gonna rock.
Okay.
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 You can do this. Sit like that.
Hang on. I got some in my tooth.
I've always wanted to ask you when I've met you. Why
Chop.
Are you called Meatloaf? Why? I mean, how did that come? Because that's not your real name.
Well, it's better than couscous.
True.
This is a true story, even though people don't think it is, and I'd never told it till the other day, but this is really it. I think it's my father, because his name was Orvis. And he hated his name, so he wanted to make sure that I grew up with something that was really stupid. And so he called me meat because I was a bright red baby and I looked like meat.
But and you're so not Chris, and that's not your kind of... You've got an alternative name, haven't you? Oh, you've got your real name.
No, they poured beer over my head and called me meat, let me tell you. They had that bartender down the street, took me down in that Texas... Y'all come on in now and say, oh, that cute little baby. They put him up there. And they say, okay, here you go, Lone Star, right over his head. And there it meet.
So the name you meet, well, it's quite a coincidence then that your surname's Loaf, isn't it?
Looking at it. Like, yeah.
But it would have been interesting. Can you imagine when they're kind of doing the top 40 and they go, number one, and we have All Doing Nothing for Love by Couscous. I can see Couscous.
Yes, that never would have made a career out of it. So we've got all of this beautiful fresh herbness.
I did pretty good.
A strong sauce. Then we freshen it up with all of the herbs. Then what we do, our spaghetti that we've cooked already, that goes in to our sauce.
Okay. How about the acting? Are you still going to do some more of that? I loved you in Fight Club. Did you see him in Fight Club?
Yeah.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah. Rob Cavallo, the producer of Hankel Teddy Bear, he said, he called me, he finally pegged me. He said, Meatloaf is an actor who acts like he can sing. And that's basically true, because when I first start singing in a studio, I tell everybody to remove the razor blade so they don't commit suicide in the first 2 hours. And after that, we get the job done. But I'm an actor. And yeah, I've got a role that I've been offered playing an undercover FBI agent, but I've just got to see if I can make the time for it.
So you're an actor first or a singer first?
An actor.
An actor first, right.
Well, see, that's always been the case.
Yeah.
Is that why you do such kind of dramatic, kind of quite long videos as well? Because you want to get that kind of acting bug out?
I would bet that's the case. Yeah. I would put money on that, yeah.
Okay, so what we do?
Plus, I'm a big giant ham. You couldn't tell from this, could you?
So we chucked in the chickpeas, we chucked in the almonds, we chucked in all the spices, then we chucked in the spaghetti. Swizzle it round your serving fork like that, so you get a really nice presentation on it.
Very nice.
And then all we do then, some of this delicious sauce. This is looking about right for what we do back home.
Me. Oh, that's good. Yeah. Does that look like yours?
Spoon that on.
Much better presentation.
And then finally, just a little bit of flaked almond over the top.
There where are the potato chips?
They're coming.
There we go. Delicious.
Here, I'll serve. Here, I'm going to serve. Here.
We're going to taste it in just a minute. Let's get over to Tim now first.
Come over and sit down and do that. We'll ask you some emails while there. James says to you, has your style, music and fashion changed since the X Factor? Do you now have a whole mass of people around you who look after you?
I have my own little stylist, Alison. She's incredible. But, a bit. I mean, I found myself, like, my music and things. Obviously, I was singing covers on X Factor. We're going to put you in clothes, but now I've had time to grow and...
Do you want to try that while we're doing that?
And... One of the outfits they put you in, you thought, oh my goodness, I just don't want to wear this.
Everything was pretty good. They sort of had me to a tee. Maybe when I wore those little hot pants and like leg warmers once when I was
pouncing
around.
But when you were on X Factor, everything you wore was hailed by all the kind of fashion magazines as the cool thing. And you kind of started a trend up.
I know, it was quite good. You did well. Yeah, definitely.
One of the questions here is from. What's that like, by the way?
Oh my lord. This is unbelievable. I mean, come on, dude.
Yeah. You high-fived on the show.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Boy band and high-fiving. Clara says to you, which is interesting, it says, what's the best piece of advice someone has given you? Why don't we use that opportunity, you've been in the industry for a few years, to give her some advice. What is the best advice you could give someone starting out in the industry?
OK.
Focus. We've only got a minute.
OK. Focus. Never give up. Never go around, under, or over. You go through. Okay. You keep fighting. You gotta be like a badger, tenacious.
Wise words.
Like, it's like a song,
man. I know.
Badger. Stop biting. You have to kill the badger. So be a badger.
Be a badger.
Yeah, they're trying to kill me now, but I'm not letting them. I have Moroccan.
In your career though, have you had times where people where you've had crossroads and you've had to make decisions and you made the wrong one, or have you always? Do you think?
No, you can never make the wrong decision. You can never look back and say that was the wrong decision. Mm. The minute you do that, you're dead. And the minute that if somebody asks you what's the highlight of your career, you always say I haven't got there yet. Because if you've got the highlight, then you got nothing to live for.
Got 10 seconds. What's the thing to longevity? What's the secret to longevity?
Stay out of the press and then hit the press. Don't stay out of it. Stay, go do something, then go away, then come back. Go away, come back, go away, come back.
That's it for this week. That's brilliant. Thanks to Diana and Meatloaf for joining us. Next Sunday, we've got fun-loving criminal Huey Morgan and Sophie Alice Baxter. They'll be here. Enjoy your Sunday, and we'll see you next week. Great advice. Thank you very much. Really good.